Hey guys, Dr. Yogendra here. So in this video, I want to talk about why I couldn't see for 2 years and why now I wear a special contact lens called a scleral lens, which allows me to see close to 20/20. Now, I've always had eye problems ever since I was a little kid. I started wearing glasses when I was around 7, 8 years old, and I started wearing contact lenses when I was around 15. But it wasn't that until I was in my late 20s that I started to notice my vision getting worse, especially at nighttime. The lights would get really glaring. I saw a series of optometrists over a 2-year period, and no one could really give me a proper answer. And finally, I found one optometrist who said, "You might have something called keratoconus." Now, I had no idea what this condition, keratoconus, meant, but come to find out, 1 in 2,000 people suffer from keratoconus. So in order to get a better understanding of keratoconus, I had a discussion recently with Dr. Michael Manning, who's a board-certified ophthalmologist in St. Petersburg, Florida.
So to talk about keratoconus is a condition that affects the front window of our eye that we refer to as the cornea. The cornea is a dome-shaped structure, somewhat like a windshield to our eye, that normally serves to focus light into the eye. And when someone has keratoconus, their cornea gradually thins and bulges forward over time. As it changes in its shape, the cornea becomes less able to bring light rays into focus, causing blurriness of the vision, making it more difficult for people to function in normal daily tasks. So keratoconus in early stages tends to have relatively nonspecific symptoms of blurry vision. So early on, patients will just simply describe having blurriness to their vision. They may have more frequent changes to their eyeglass prescription. And so it's not unusual because of that in some of the early stages of keratoconus, it can go sort of missed or undiagnosed. So a number of patients may go through a number of years before someone ultimately diagnoses that they have the condition. And so as the condition progresses, some of the types of changes patients will have in their prescription can be increases in the amount of nearsightedness in their prescription or increases in the amount of the measurements of astigmatism. Astigmatism really just meaning that the curvature of the eye is more irregular. Some use the analogy of a football shape as opposed to a basketball shape, a football shape being flatter in one axis and steeper in another axis. And so as that develops, the cornea becomes more curved or more steep in a certain axis that changes the prescription. So some of the risk factors or causes for keratoconus are interesting because in general, it's not entirely clear to doctors why patients get keratoconus. There certainly can be some linkage to genetic risk factors. It's believed that about 1 out of every 10 people who have keratoconus may have a parent that has it too. But it's not that it's only passed by genetics. There's believed to be associations with other conditions, such as eye allergies, which tends to go along with a habit of eye rubbing. So a very common association for many people who have keratoconus is that they oftentimes are prone to rubbing the eyes, and that can relate to other conditions that are risk factors due to the issue of rubbing. Some connective tissue conditions, such as Marfan's or Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, can be also risk factors as well. Yeah, so keratoconus is diagnosed really through a regular complete eye exam with one's eye doctor or ophthalmologist. Often in kind of, as I had mentioned earlier, in earlier stages, it may go initially undiagnosed, though some of the initial clues to it developing may be changes in measurements called keratometry, kind of curvature measurements of the eye, changes that show up in a patient's prescription. One of the tests that can be very helpful in early diagnosis of keratoconus is a mapping of a patient's cornea, something referred to as a corneal topography. And so that's real helpful at detecting some of the early changes. There's some other different technologies that we utilize that also map the eye or measure different layers of the cornea to determine some of the early changes, such as thinning of the central cornea. So for treatment of keratoconus, it's much dependent upon symptoms, as well as how advanced the condition may be. In early stages, people can benefit simply from changes in their eyeglasses. As the condition progresses, people can need to use different types of contact lenses that can include types such as gas permeable or scleral contact lenses. And so these are a number of the treatment options in kind of mild to moderate stages of keratoconus. As things progress further, there can be a need to consider treatments to try to slow the progression of the condition. One of the ones that's been a great breakthrough has been corneal collagen cross-linking. And this is where a light-based treatment is used to strengthen the fibers within the cornea that are the collagen fibers, so as to try to avoid further advancement or progression of the condition. Other treatments that can be used are for changes to the curvature of the cornea. So some will consider getting a type of treatment called Intax that's used to help alter the curvature of the cornea in somebody who has keratoconus. And then finally, in some more advanced cases, if someone has real severe keratoconus that may develop scarring to their cornea, that can require corneal transplantation. Now, anywhere along the way, in the mild or moderate or other stages, as we think about treatment, some of those treatments can also entail surgical vision correction options that patients will consider, because patients who have keratoconus are not good candidates for LASIK, as that would be a concern that's a contraindication to proceed with a procedure of that sort. However, there are treatments such as what's abbreviated as ICL or Visian ICL, which stands for implantable collamer lens. This is an implantable lens that can be used in patients with keratoconus to further correct the vision. Although, of course, we have to assess the extent of their keratoconus to determine whether they might be a candidate for that.
So hopefully you guys have a better understanding about keratoconus, and if you suspect you might have it, to speak with an optometrist or an ophthalmologist. And if you are in the Florida or St. Petersburg area, I will post Dr. Manning's website and link to his clinic down below in this video. So if you like this video, hit that like button, click the bell so you get notifications when I post a new video, and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. And until the next time, ciao.